This time we want to prepare ourselves for our history bit. And as we get into the history bit, I want to say a couple things with regard to the history bit. For those who watch us regularly and who attend regularly, you know that our history bit is a short piece that we have in the service before we get into the main teaching, where we want to help educate Zion in the things of the Creator. We want to help bring information that is essential to your growth and to have a proper understanding of scriptures. Now today what we're going to do, we're going to be sharing a little something about the Hebrew manuscripts. You might say, well, what are the Hebrew manuscripts? We're referring to the history of the transmission of the Hebrew scriptures. Basically, in a nutshell, we want to talk about how we got our Bible. But I'm only speaking today with respect to the Hebrew scriptures, that portion of the scriptures from Bereshit to Malachi. That's what I'm talking about today. And it's important that we do understand how we got these scriptures to us, how they were transmitted, and which ones did Yahshua and the apostles use in comparison to the ones that we use today. So what I'm going to do, I'm just going to give a brief rundown of the first set of scriptures and how they came down to us, real briefly. So, we all know that the scriptures in their origin, the first set that we have, well, all of us might not know. So if you don't know, this is how it came. The first set of scriptures came through Moses. So if you look in your Bibles and you see Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy, when you see those books, those are the first five books. Those are attributed to Moses. And those books are regarded as the Torah. Now, according to the records that we have as far as dates are concerned, the five books of Moses called Torah, and most of us are familiar with Torah, those books were compiled in 1446 BCE, or 1446 BCE. So roughly 1,446 years before the Common Era, or commonly called before the coming of the Messiah, those books were written. And those books were given to the leaders of Israel, to Joshua, the judges, the priests, and they made copies of the books, as well as a copy of the book being in the tabernacle. The next generation of manuscripts came from Samuel. Most of us, when we read our Bibles, we're familiar with Samuel. Samuel was a priest. Samuel was one that was used mightily by the Most High. Samuel was the one who anointed Saul and anointed David as king. Samuel had a school of prophets. And Samuel, what he did was take those scriptures that he had, which was composed of Torah, those five books that were attributed to Moses, and also the book of Joshua. He took those and compiled them all together. That set was called the Neothic. And that was compiled and put together by Samuel in 1050 BCE. So roughly around about the time when Saul and David were on the scene, that's roughly 11th century BCE, Samuel had compiled those set of scriptures. and preserved them, and those set of scriptures were passed down through the kings. Now, we know there was a time in the history of our ancient fathers where they began to go into the worship of pagan idols, and they actually lost the book of scripture. A king by the name of Josiah, he found the book of scriptures. Well, actually, those who were going through the stuff found the scriptures. And he's the one that's noted for the recovery of the scriptures and the restoration of the worship of the Most High. So Joshua recovered those scriptures that Samuel had passed down. And those scriptures that Joshua had found were scriptures that were in existence during the time of the captivities. Those who are not familiar with the captivities, our ancient fathers went through captivities. The 10 tribes in the north were taken by the Assyrians. The other tribes in the south, in Judah, they were taken by the Babylonians. Now, when the 10 tribes in the north were taken out and were taken over into Assyria, the Assyrians transplanted peoples from other nations and brought them into the northern part of Israel. And they ended up mixing in with the remnant of people that was in northern Israel, and they became what we call the Samaritans. All right? Well, those people had the scriptures given to them so that they might know how to live and walk in the ways of Elohim so that they wouldn't die, because, you know, they coming from pagan lifestyles, and they were living a life that was not according to the Torah, and wild beasts was coming out and killing them. And so they had to ask for a priest to come and bring scriptures so that they might live according to the commandments. Because the Most High don't allow folk to live in his land and not keep his commandments. That's why our ancient fathers were kicked out. All right? So the scriptures that Joshua or Josiah had found, those scriptures, which were originally put together by Samuel, those scriptures were given to the Samaritans. Now you might ask, why are you going through all this history like this? There's a reason. Just hold on for a couple more minutes. There's a reason. We'll be through with the history bit. So we have the Samaritans in northern Israel with a set of scriptures that had been passed down from the time of Samuel. When our Judean Israelites were in Babylonian captivity, they had some scriptures also. They had the books of the prophets. And after they came out of captivity and went into the land of Israel again, or returned back to the land of Israel again, Ezra put together a whole set of scriptures. Now, it's believed the reason why Ezra put those scriptures together, compiled them, because there's a number of views as to how Ezra put the Bible together in his time. Some say he went to northern Israel and copied the scriptures that they had. Some say there were possibly fragments and pieces of the Torah, or there may have been some Torah scrolls that they had when they were in Babylonian captivity. Now, the reason for all of that is because when the Babylonians came into the land of Judah, they burned up the temple, they burned up the libraries, they burned up the records. And so unless there were some priests that may have had those scrolls of the scriptures, then for all intents and purposes, based upon what we know, everything was burned up. But at any rate, Ezra was the one who developed the next set of scriptures. And that set was called the Quatrodecium. You say, well, why is it called the Quatrodecium? It's believed that there were 14 men along with him that were responsible, or should I say 13 men plus him, there were 14 that were responsible for putting the Bible together. And so through Ezra, they had compiled the Torah, the prophets, and the writings. They compiled all of that together. Now, there was another set of scriptures that were developed as time went on. And we know during the time of Ezra, let me give you that date, the time when Ezra had compiled those scriptures together, now we're down to 458 and 445 BCE. So now, time is moving forward. We had started from 1446 BC with Moses to 1050 BCE with Samuel. Now we're down to 458 to 445 BCE with Ezra. And about almost a couple hundred years from the time Ezra had produced that copy, there was a translation of the Hebrew into Greek called the Septuagint. That occurred in 282 BCE. That was done by 70 elders in Alexandria, Egypt. Now note, these are all Israelites, y'all. Hebrews. We translated our own scriptures. All right? We translated it into the Greek because most of our people who were scattered throughout the empire of the Greeks were speaking the Greek language. Sort of like how, you know, today where you have so many people in the world that speak English, you take the Bible and you translate it into English. Well, that's what they did here in 282 BCE. Now, I need to say something about the Septuagint, because the Septuagint was the translation of Scripture that most of the Judean Israelites use throughout all of the Greek Empire, even into the Roman Empire. Matter of fact, the Septuagint and the Hebrew copy that Ezra had produced is what was used during the time of our Messiah. So if you want to know what was the scriptures that Messiah used and the apostles used, they used the Septuagint, and they use that Hebrew text that the Septuagint was translated from. That's what they use. That's an older version. Now, there was another development of the Hebrew scriptures in 160 AD or 160 CE. And this is called the Masoretic Text. Masoretic texts, they were produced by Rabbi Yosef ben Halafta. And that Masoretic text was held primarily, it was developed primarily by those who are the Pharisaic rabbinic Jews. So the Pharisaic rabbinic Jews developed the Masoretic text. Now, the Masoretic text is the text that the Bibles we have today are translated from. So if you open your Bible, such as King James Version, any English translation from the Western Christian churches, the text that is used is the text from the Masoretes, from the Pharisaic rabbinic Jews. So those are the ones who produced that text. Now, the reason why I'm sharing all of this is first of all, to help us to have an understanding of the history behind it. But second, it's because I have noted that there are some differences between the Masoretic text and the text that Ezra produced, and also the Septuagint that was translated from Ezra's text. And in discovering these differences, and there are some major differences. It has caused me to begin to look at the Septuagint and also the Samaritan Pentateuch with greater value than the Masoretic texts that our Bibles come from. And you might say, well, why would you say that? And why would you present this information? Being a more, a teacher who is bent on preserving the truth of the Creator. For Yahshua said that the scripture cannot be broken. And when Yahshua made that statement, he was referring to those scriptures that were in use in his time, which were the ones that were produced by Ezra and translated from Ezra's copy, which is the Quadridecium and also the Septuagint. When we see differences, it is important that we evaluate it and that we begin to look at what is most authentic. The reason why I am finding that there is a greater value in these earlier manuscripts is because with the discovery of the Dead Sea Scrolls, which were found in the Qumran caves, and then they were compared to the manuscripts that exist now, the biblical manuscripts that exist now, when they were compared, the Dead Sea Scrolls had more of an alliance with the Septuagint, the Samaritan Torah, and the Quadridecium, or the scrolls that Ezra had put together. And when we have these kinds of discoveries and things that are brought to us, it helps to bring a confirmation as to the word being credible. In other words, when you have two or three witnesses that attest to certain writings, in other words, they all saying the same thing. It's like if you have the Masoretic text, you compare that with the earlier text, but then you have these Dead Sea Scrolls that's saying the same thing, or has more identicality to these older manuscripts than the manuscript that was produced in 160 AD, I would think we would have to look at those older manuscripts and begin to look at them as being more credible sources for scriptures for us. For Messiah said the scriptures cannot be broken. Well, thank you so much for listening to the History Bit. I know that the History Bit was a little lengthy. We do want to provide the information because we feel it's important that Zion needs to be educated in the way of Elohim. And what I've discovered is that sometimes the best way for me to be able to help to educate Zion, other than in just the teaching of the scriptures directly, is to incorporate this information in our services.